Hello, students. So, today's session is a continuation of our previous lectures on calculus. We will be mainly working on differentiability and its problem in this session. And in this session, we will be working on more challenging problems, okay? But as you know, that when I mention challenging, it simply means that they are a bit tricky. So, all you need to understand the underlying tricks, okay? Only then you can easily solve the problem. There is nothing so big thing here, yes. And definitely to achieve that much of expertiseness, it's important to continue your practice and practice and practice, okay? Okay, so let's start. Given f1 equals 1, f1 equals 3, then you have to calculate the derivative of this expression at x equal 1, okay? So, clearly you can see that this, it is a composite function, right? You have three functions, fx, then f of fx, then f of fx, yes? So, we know that from the composite function theorem, that f of gx, if this is our, let's say this is capital Fx, then f dash x is f dash of gx times g dash x, right? Now, if gx, for the convenience sake, assume gx as in this way, say it is h of kx, okay, then similarly, by the same formula of composite function theorem, like this one, we can write this as h dash of kx times k dash x, yes? So, what I am trying to make you understand that, if you now replace this gx by h of kx by this expression here, so what you will get? You will get fx as f of h of kx, right? Therefore, f dash x, this is, now we will just substitute the value from here. F dash h of kx times g dash x, and we know that g dash x is h dash kx times k dash x. Okay? Yes? Now follow the pattern here. We have k dash x, I mean follow from the end. K dash x times h dash k dash x times f dash h of kx. Yes? So we'll do the same thing here. If this is our capital Fx, then f dash x, what we have to do? K dash x. So, the function which is at the core of inside of this function, okay. So, which function is core part, right? Kx is the core part, right? So, this will come first. So, here, since everything is fx, so f dash x, so it is this one, right? I am using different color so that you can understand. Then, we have h dash of kx. So, then we have f dash of fx, yes, it is our, this one, yes, and the final one is f dash of f of fx, right, yes, okay, so we have obtained our this as this, I am just writing here in a fresh way so that this thing we can understand it, yes? And we have another function here, that is fx square, okay? Let's mention this as gx. So, what is our g dash x? Similarly, composite function theorem we will apply here, it is 2 of fx times f dash x, right? Yes? Composite function theorem, what it is saying. Now, what we are going to do, we are going to add these two. So, we have f dash is fx, f dash fx times f dash x plus this expression 2fx f dash x, yes? And we have to evaluate this expression at x equals 1, yes? So this gives f dash is f of 1 times f dash f of 1 times f dash 1 plus, I am just replacing x by 1, that's all. This, yes? Now, it is given that f dash 1 is 3 and f 1 is 1. So, we will start from here. We have our f 1 is 1 and f dash 1 is 3, right? Here, f dash 1 is 3 and f 1 is 1. Similarly, here, f 1 is 1. So, it will be f of 1, right? And f1 is again 1, so it will be f dash 1. Yes, any doubt? See, I am repeating once more. F1 is 1, right? So this is 1. So this is f of 1. Now f1 is again 1. F1 is again 1. So it will be 1. So finally we have f dash 1. Okay. I hope this part is understandable now. The substitution part, yes. Now we will just evaluate the value, that's all. So we have f dash 1 is 3. F dash 1 is again 3. So we have 3 times 3 times 3 plus 2 times 1 times 3. 27 plus 6. 3 times, it is 3 cubed, 27. This is 6. This is 33, right? So we have our answer is D, yes? Given 2y is this expression, we have to evaluate dy dx. Now, let's first write the expression 2y equals given cotangent inverse of root over 3 cosine x plus sine x by cosine x root over 3 sine x, yes? And we have this. Now, observe that if we know, we can clearly now do straightforward differentiation. So, if we do this, then it will be 2 dy dx. Then we have to again differentiate this whole thing. It will be a very tedious work, isn't it so? So, here we are going to apply some tricks so that our life becomes easier. Okay. So, what we are going to do is, we will try to do some magic so that this cotangent inverse gets evaluated, okay? So, we want to vanish this inverse function. Otherwise, we know that inverse function differentiation, oh my god, it is extremely hectic and tedious. So, we will try to vanish this cotangent inverse function, okay? And there is a way. There is a way to do that from this expression only. Try this by yourself, okay? At least think for a few minutes. Pause the video. Think for 2-3 minutes. That's how you can do. Think about applying the geometry formula, okay? Especially trigonometric formula you can apply here. So first of all, think that how you can vanish this function. So we have one cotangent inverse function. So if you get another cotangent function, then we know cot inverse, this expression is x, right? So try to bring that one from this expression. I have given you the hint. So you try this, okay? Meanwhile, I am doing this here. So what you have to basically do is, let me just erase this. So let's write this expression first here. Root over 3 cosine x plus sine x cosine x minus root 3 sine x. So we need this function as cotangent of something, right? That is cosine of something by sine of something. Yes? Since this is in the ratio, so that's why I write this expression. I am trying to bring this as some cosine by sine expression. So in the numerator we need cosine and in the denominator we need sine. Okay. So what we are going to do, since we have some addition here, so we divide both numerator and denominator by 2. Why we divide, you will get to know in the next step. But I think it is, many students are familiar with this trick. By this time, I think 95% of students already get the idea that what we are trying to do. So this, we can write this as cosine of pi by 6 minus x. And this we can write as sine of pi by 6 minus x. Isn't it so? By cosine a plus b formula, yes. So we obtain this as cotangent of pi by 6 minus x. Okay. So cot inverse, we have, yes, now see, we get our desired thing. So this is our pi by 6 minus x. So till now everything is fine, but if you are in hurry and attempt to write this expression in this way, like you are thinking, oh, we have achieved the inverse function and the main function together, so we can write this in this way, then this is a clearly wrong concept. Okay, you cannot write this as in this way. Okay, well, to be honest, you cannot write cot inverse of cot x equals x. In general, this is not true. Okay, because inverse function has some rules and principles you have to follow. And from that principle, the thing is something like this, that the range of cotangent inverse of x, let me use some different color, range of cotangent inverse of x, I am just doing some rough work here, later I will erase this, okay? So this is basically lies from 0 to pi. It is defined in this way, okay? That whatever be x, cotangent inverse of x will always lie between 0 to pi. It is a definition. So you have to follow that definition whenever you are applying cot inverse x in your problem, okay? Suppose in your problem, you apply cot inverse x in such a way that its range go beyond this interval, then you are doing wrong. Conceptually, mathematically, it is wrong. And you will get 0 for that. So you should not force cot inverse x to go beyond this interval, because it is defined. The definition has been restricted inside this interval. So we cannot go beyond that. Having said that, say cot inverse of cot x, okay, let's say x belongs to, or let me just write this as theta. Let's say theta belongs to pi here in this interval. So, will you write this as theta? Definitely not, right? Because in otherwise, the range is going beyond pi, yes? Because theta lie between pi to 2 pi, yes? So, you cannot write this as pi. You have to write this as cot inverse of cot theta. You need to subtract pi from here, okay? Only then the range is coming inside this interval, isn't it so? Because theta is lies between here. I mean, if you minus pi from theta, you obtain this thing, yes? So, now it is inside this interval. So, therefore, cot inverse of cot theta equals theta minus pi when theta belongs in this interval, yes? Similarly, if we assume now that theta belongs to, say, minus pi to 0, okay? Then, will you be able to write this as equals theta? Definitely not, yes? Otherwise, again, it is going beyond this interval, the value of theta, yes? The value of the expression that will come to the right-hand side of this inverse function should lie inside this interval. We have to restrict that at any cost. Therefore, what we are going to do, we are going to add a plus here. Yes, only then the right-hand side expression will be inside this interval, right? Because theta here is less than equal to 0, greater than equal minus pi. Therefore, theta plus pi, this is pi to 0. So, it is going inside this interval. So, we have to take care of that thing, okay? So, whatever be the expression, this should lie inside this expression. I mean, inside this interval, okay? So, we have to take care of this thing while working with cos inverse function, sine inverse function, or any trigonometric inverse function. We need to know the range first, and then we have to apply the tricks. We have to do the tricks, okay? Okay. So now we have to determine that what is happening in this case actually. So x has given lying between 0 to pi by 2, okay? Therefore, pi by 6 minus x, this will be minus of pi by 3, pi by 6, yes? You can do this simplification in your copy, it will take 2-3 steps, but I have just do this in my mind because it is very simple. So, pi by 6 minus x, I mean this function will lie inside this interval, okay? So now, so as I mentioned, if you tempted to write this as pi by 6 minus x, then definitely it is wrong because the range is going outside of this interval, right? Because it is negative. It can run from minus pi by 3 to pi by 6. That is, it is running from minus pi by 3 to 0, which is outside of this interval, isn't it so? So, we cannot write this as this exactly. We need to follow some restriction. So, that's what I am going to do now. I hope you are understanding, right? What I am trying to say. If you have any doubts, let me know in the comment section, okay? So, we will now partition the domain actually in this way. So, our first partition will be something like this. When pi by 6 minus x is strictly positive, and when pi by 6 minus x is strictly negative, okay? I mean, strictly non-positive, it can be 0 also. So, in this case, what will happen? We can definitely write this as pi by 6 minus x, this expression, because this is lying between 0 to pi. So, there is nothing to worry about it. We need to do some tricks here. So, first I will write this as in this way. Then I will check it by adding what number it is going inside this interval. So, if we now add pi Observe that this expression, I mean, if we now add here pi, then what is happening? Pi minus pi by 3 less than pi plus pi by 6 minus x less than equal pi. So this expression now going inside this interval, yes, because this expression is greater than 0 and extreme side, the right side is already pi. Yes, so if we now add pi, then this expression is going inside this interval. Therefore, when pi by 6 minus x lies in this interval, then cotangent inverse of cotangent of this function or this whole expression will be equal to this thing. Okay? Yes? Should I have to repeat once again? See, this thing is clear, right? Because this thing is already inside this interval. Pi by 6 minus x is already inside this interval when we have already assumed this. So the concern is about this one, okay? We have pi by 6 minus x running from negative pi by 3 to 0. But we cannot directly substitute this, right? We cannot, if we directly substitute this, then what is happening? We obtaining the value of pi by 6 minus x, I mean the range of cot inverse x, outside of this interval 0 to pi. So we need to restrict that thing inside this interval. So we have add pi, which restrict the expression, this expression inside this interval. Okay? And you can ask that why we add pi, why we didn't add any other number. Well, in that case, we know that cotangent of pi plus x is cotangent of x. Yes? For that reason, we add pi. Because the function will remain same. For that reason. Okay? We do not want the function to be changed. We just want the value to lay inside this interval, inside the range that is defined for cot inverse function. Okay? Okay. So now, we obtain our 2y in this way. It is pi by 6 minus x 0, pi by 6 minus x. Now, if we simplify this, this is basically nothing but 0 less than x, pi by 6, okay? And we have pi plus pi by 6 minus x when minus pi by 3 equals 0. We have a square here, it will be whole square. Yes? So we obtain our 2y as in this way. Yes? So now we are going to perform our differentiation. So we have, it is simple now, 2y1, y1 means divide x, okay? It will be 2 of pi by 6 minus x times minus 1 for this case and 2 7 pi by 6 minus x times minus 1. It is for this one, okay? Let me just write down this. Let me say, I am not writing this expression here because I do not have space here. This is say 1. So for 1 and for 2 we have this condition, okay? Simplifying y1, this 2 and 2 will get cancelled out. This is x minus pi by 6 when this thing and x minus 7 pi by x when the function is not differentiable at x equal pi by 6, so that's why I remove the equality here, okay? Yes? Any doubt? I just simplify this from here to here. Any doubt in understanding this problem? Let me know in the comment section, okay? Given y equals this expression and f dash x equals sin square x, we have to evaluate dy dx, okay? So, let's write down the expression first. Hmm. This implies dy dx f dash of this thing, and then we have to differentiate this one, right? 2x minus 1 upon x square plus 1 dash. Yes, it is just a little bit of calculation here, but the problem is straightforward, isn't it, sir? So what is the differentiation of this? We have to apply the quotient formula of differentiation. Yes, so it is x square plus 1 whole square. Here we have 2 times x square plus 1 minus 2x minus 1 times 2x. Yes, we know the how it is, u dash v minus u v dash upon v square. Now see, u dash 2x minus 1 dash, that is 2 times v u times v dash. What is our v? V is x square plus 1, therefore v dash is 2x, yes, upon v square. Simple, very simple. So now, given f dash x equals sine square x, therefore this is sine square. In this case, our x, let's say x is 2x minus 1 x square plus 1, and given f dash capital X is sine square capital of X. Yes, because whatever will be here, it will be same here, input will be same. Yes, so replacing the input, and now we have to just simplify this. It is 2x square plus 2 minus 4x square plus 2x. Yes, x square plus 1 whole square. We obtain from here, it is minus 2x square, yes, plus 2x plus 2 upon x square plus 1 whole square times sine square 2x minus 1 upon x square plus 1. Yes, any doubt? It's simple, right? Little bit of computation, that's all, but simple, straightforward. Given x equals sec theta minus cosine theta, and y equals sec n theta minus cosine n theta, in this way, you have to show that this equals this. Okay? Okay, so I would suggest you to try this, okay? Do not follow my session completely. You should try this. Maybe you will be wrong, or maybe you have to do some extra computation, but you should try, okay? So the procedure of solving this type of problem, whenever we have an expression which we need to solve, which we need to evaluate, is something like this. So we will determine this side as LHS and this side as RHS, left hand side and right hand side, and we will take left hand side and try to arrive RHS. Okay, why we will take LHS first? Because we have an expression, something to do with. Yes, so if we take RHS, then it would be difficult to arrive in at this step. It is possible, it may be possible, but it would be difficult. It may not be computation effective. Okay, so we will start from LHS. So we have our LHS as x square plus 4 times y1 square. What is y1? y1 is this. It is a short form of writing the differentiation. So y1 is dy dx, y2 is d2y dx2 in this way, y3 is d3y dx3 in this way. So let's first write down the expression first. We have our y equals, since we are interested in the left hand side, so, and left hand side, the only expression that can bother us is y, right? Because rests are directly from the problem. Secant n theta minus cosine n theta. So what is our y1? Now y1 is dy dx, right? But we have our expression here as theta. So we can write dy dx as chain rule dy d theta times d theta dx. Okay? So now let's differentiation both sides with respect to d theta. So we have dy d theta. This gives us n secant n minus 1 theta times secant theta tan theta, yes? Cosine n minus 1 theta sine theta. Any doubt? I'm just doing straightforward differentiation. That's all. This, now I can take n common. So let's write down a bracket. And take n outside of the bracket. Sec n theta, secant n theta times tangent theta plus cosine n minus 1 theta times sine theta, yes? Now observe that. What you have to observe is, this cosine of n minus 1 theta, we can write in this way, cosine n theta times sine theta upon cosine theta, yes? Now this one is tangent theta, right? Why I am writing in this way? So that I can also pull out tan theta outside of this bracket. So, yes. I want to write this in this way. So we have our dy d theta, that is y theta, let's say, as this expression. Now this times d theta dx is our dy dx, right? So what is our d theta dx? We have given our x as secant theta minus cosine theta, yes? So from here we have dx d theta is secant theta tan theta plus sine theta, yes? This again we will simplify like earlier. We have, we can write this as secant theta tan theta plus, yes? Actually our intention is to pull out tan theta from here also so that these two expressions can get cancelled out. Did you understand the motivation of writing this expression in this way? Did you understand why I wrote this expression in this way? Why I divide and multiply with cosine theta with sine theta, yes? Well, the motivation is this. I will start from here again. See, we have our y theta is this expression we obtained, right? This is straightforward. There is no tricks here. Here I have applied some tricks. That part I will come to later, but from here we have no tricks here, right? But we have a tan theta here. And from this expression we have dy dx as dy d theta times d theta dx. Okay? So in the expressions of dy d theta, that is here, we have a tan theta, right? We have a tan theta. And from here, in the expressions of dx d theta, we are bringing a tan theta. Tan theta is not coming here directly, but we are bringing it. Why we are bringing it? Because if we now invert this expression, d theta dx, we have in our hand this thing, right? Correct? In our hand, we have now this expression. Now, if we now multiply these two things, observe that this tan theta will get cancelled out. Yes? Isn't it so? So, that is the motivation. We need to simplify our calculation. We should not make it complex. So, one of the functions get vanished. One of the functions get eliminated. So, it is simplified. Isn't it so? So, that was the motivation. Bring tan theta here with this trick, okay? So now if we multiply these two, we obtain our y1, sorry, I am using black color, we obtain our y1 as y theta times d theta dx, which is n tangent theta times secant n theta plus cosine n theta upon tangent theta secant theta plus cosine theta. this will get cancelled out. Our life is little easy now. This we can write in secant n theta plus cosine n theta upon secant theta plus cosine theta, okay? So, this is our y1, right? Now, if we take square to both sides, we have our n square secant n theta plus cosine n theta square upon secant theta plus cosine theta square, okay? Now, we will evaluate this expression, which is our LHS. So, we have secant theta minus cosine theta whole square plus 4. I am just substituting these values. Y1 square. So, this is secant square theta plus cosine square theta minus 2 plus 4. Yes? Times y1 square, because secant theta times cosine theta is 1. So we have here secant theta plus cosine theta whole square times y1 square, okay? Now, if we substitute the value of y1 square here, we have secant theta cosine theta whole square times n square secant theta plus cosine n theta whole square . So this and this will get cancelled out. So you obtain here n square secant theta plus cosine of n theta whole square. Now this we can write in this way, n square secant theta minus cosine n theta. Same strategy. The way we expand this and the same way we are building this. Plus 4, yes? Yes? And this is nothing but our, what is this? This is our y, right? So, y square plus 4. Yay! We obtain our RHS. If you have any doubts, let me know. Given if y equals this expression, then the value of this is equal to this. We have to evaluate that which one of this is correct, yes? So given our y is a e in x plus b e in x, therefore y1, that is dy dx, is a m e m x plus b m e n x, yes? And y2 implies that is d2y dx2, as I mentioned, a, it will be m square, yes? E m x plus b times m square e m x. So now we will just substitute the value in this expression. Y2 minus m plus n y1 plus n n y. We have our y2 is a m square e m x plus b m square e n x minus m plus n times a m e m x plus b n e m x plus MNY. Yes, we have to simplify now. AM square EMX plus BN square EMX minus, we have, look, we have from here, we will get 1 AM square, right? M times AM, EMX, and we'll also get this N times, and we'll also get this N times BN, so BN square EMX. So this thing will get cancelled out, and I mean, this and this, and this and this will get cancelled out, right? And whatever we left over is minus AMN EMX minus BMN EMX. Yes? N times this and M times this plus MN Y, yes, because I think that this is Y actually. If we take minus MN common, so we have AEMX plus BENX, yes, I am thinking. So this expression is Y, AEMX plus BENX. So we have here minus MNY plus MNY, and again, voila, this thing gets cancelled out, so the final answer is 0. So the correct option is B. Yes, given y equals this expression, and you have to evaluate this expression. Similarly, writing down the problem first, we have sine inverse x whole square plus k sine inverse x. Okay, we have y1, this equals to sine inverse of x, chain rule, yes, and then sine inverse of x, differentiation of this one, plus k sine inverse of x, differentiation of this one. Now we know that differentiation of sine inverse of x is this expression, right? Formula, there is nothing big thing here, just formula, that's all. So we have our y1 is this. Now, if we try to differentiate this expression from here, it will be a very hectic job because we have something square root type of thing, okay? So we need to apply some tricks here. So what we are going to do, let's first bring this expression here. So what we are going to do now, let's square to both sides, okay? Because it will be a very hectic computation if we now differentiate from here directly. So if we now square both sides, so at least we will get free from this square root. And this is our y1 square. And here we will have this kind of thing, yes? Yes? Now expand this, it will be 4 sine inverse x whole square plus 4k sine inverse of x plus k square, right? Now observe that this is nothing but our y, right? Yes? Isn't it so? So this we can write in this way, because this is y, yay, the expression becomes simple now. And from here, we have this 4y plus k square. Now we will differentiate to both sides. So in this case, 2y1, y2 plus, because differentiation of y1 square is 2y1, y2, right? Yes? And this is minus 2x times y1 square. I am just applying product formula, that's all. 4y1. this is, so this 1, 2 will get cancelled out. 2y1, I think 2y1 will get cancelled out, yes. y2 minus xy1, because 2y1 and 2y1, this is 2, yes. Okay, so yes, I think this expression came on the left hand side, isn't it? So 1 minus x square y2 minus, so we obtain our answer is just given if x equals this and y equals this, then the value of this, you have to determine the value of this y2. So first we need y1 and then the question of y2 is coming, right? So what would be our y1? So our y is 3 second t. So from here we have dy dt is 3 second t times tan t, yes? And our x is 3 tan t. Therefore from here we have our dx dt is 3 second square t, right? Yes, I am just applying straightforward formula, that's all. Let's mention this as 1 and this as 2. Now, if you see that 1 divided by 2, this is our dy dt upon dx dt, which ultimately turned into dy dx, yes, that is our y1, equals this 3 second t times tangent t, and this is 3 second square t, this one, okay? So this 3 second t, 1 3 second t will get cancelled out, and we have left in the numerator tangent t and in the denominator second t, okay? Which is nothing but we have sine of t, yes? So we have our y1 equals sine of t, but we need y2. And also at this point. So keep differentiating. We have y2 is ddx of sin t, right? Which is nothing but we can write ddt of sin t times general dt upon dx. Now ddt of sin t we know, cosine t, and this is dx dt, and we obtain our dx dt as 3 second square t cosine t 3 second square t. Now you can either substitute the value here, or you can do one more step here, like you can write this as 1 third of cosine t times 1 upon second square t, which is basically cosine square t, right? So you can write this as directly as cosine cube t, yes? So now if we substitute the value t at pi by 4, we have cosine pi by 4 cube, it is 1 third, 1 by 2 root 2, right? Because cosine pi by 4 is 1 by root 2, and 1 by root 2 cube is 1 by 2 root 2, so this is, yes? Okay, so I am ending the session here. If you have any doubts in understanding any problems, do let me know in the comment section, okay? See you in another session.